Don't you thank God for being in His presence? Oh my God, I thank God for the Spirit of the living God. Oh my God. There's no place I'd rather be. There's another song that says, don't sing this one though. The safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. In the will of God. Today I believe you're in the will of God by being in His presence. So we're going to get into this word. I want to thank God for every person who's joining us. I want to thank God for those who are joining us online this morning. Thank God for you who are joining us in person. Amen. So glad to see every face. And I know that Sister Jill may have already done this, but I just want to know this is your first time here at Harvest. I just want you to raise your hand. You don't have to stand. I just want you to raise your hand. I see a first time. I see two first time persons over here. I see another first time guest over here. I see Brother Lawrence's mom over here. Praise the Lord. Amen. Saints of Harvest. Saints of Harvest. Can we just give them a hand, clap of praise? Can we just bless God's name for every guest, every visitor, every person who's in the sanctuary? Amen. And I know many of you are not first time guests, but you're not yet members. I want to tell you, there's a shady line for me between membership and just and guests, because I'm not concerned about whether or not you sign your name on a dotted line and say you're a member, because in heaven, the Lord knows where your heart is. Amen. The Lord knows. It's just like, it doesn't matter where you move in the world, your mama's house is always your home. Right? And I just want to encourage you just keep on coming to church. You just keep on being faithful. Listen, I know every day is not beautiful. I know every day you're not perfect. I understand that, but just keep coming. Don't ever be out of the fight. Don't ever be out of the fight. One thing they say about Navy SEALs, the motto is that you're going to have to kill them to beat them. And that's what I told the devil one time. I said, devil, you're going to have to kill me to beat me. Because I don't have anything to go back to. I wonder if you've come far enough in your walk with Christ, or at least come far enough in your life now that we realize you really don't have anything to go back. There's really nothing back there. There's really nothing back there. We're going to go to a scripture today. Thank you, Jesus. I want to give honor to my wife in her absence. She's traveling right now for the Brazil family. We're praying for my family and her family. I recently lost my mother about a month ago, and my wife's father is my father-in-law is not doing well, so we're praying for him. Right? We know God is a miracle worker. We know God is a what? He's a miracle worker. He's a miracle. And listen, why not be crazy enough to believe that he can work another miracle? He saved you. That was a miracle. He saved me. So we're praying for the Brazil family. And I just want you to keep my wife lifted up in prayer, Pastor Yaz. Amen. Give honor to God and Jesus Christ. Give honor to the Holy Spirit who's in this place. Let's go into this word. We're going to be in Matthew, the 4th chapter, and the 1st verse through the 11th verse. Matthew, the 4th chapter, verse 1 through 11. I will read those verses, and they have them on the screen for you. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. When he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, the tempter is the devil, Satan. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou shalt dash thy foot against a stone. And Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then saith Jesus unto him, get thee, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. Amen. I want to speak to you today very briefly from the subject tempted. I want to make it simple today. I think everybody can relate to being what? Tempted. Tempted. Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you right where we're sitting. We ask for the Spirit of the Lord to minister to our hearts and our minds, and we will give you glory. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen. 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 For those that have been with us for a couple of weeks, couple of months, you know that we're in a series about the book of the Gospel of Matthew. It's called the Gospel of Matthew Made Simple. If you haven't seen the Bible studies, please go and watch them. They will explain the Gospel of Matthew in its simplest terms. Last week in our Bible study, we talked about John the Baptist and how he told the truth in Matthew, the third chapter. Those of you who have heard of John the Baptist know that John the Baptist was the one that took Jesus down into the water, right? And even though Jesus had committed no sins, Jesus submitted himself to this water baptism for the sole purpose of identifying with sinners. Some of us won't take the blame for what we did do, let alone take the blame for what somebody else did. So Jesus submitted himself to this water baptism by this man named John the Baptist. And the interesting thing was that water baptism at this particular stage, this water baptism, was extremely important. Because this particular water baptism marked a turning point in Jesus' ministry. A turning point. How many of you know that you need a turning point? Everybody needs a turning point. Everyone needs a time in their life where there was a single event or there's a series of events, and that event happens and it alters the trajectory of your life. Some of you, while you're thinking about your turning point. You're thinking about that relationship that went sour. You're thinking about that heartbreak that left you 20 pounds lighter. When I met my wife, she had just gone through a terrible breakup. And she said she hadn't even come out of her room for a month. I think whoever that rascal was. How many of you know that when one bad thing happens to somebody else, it could be your blessing? Amen. I want to thank you. And so when I met her, she told me that she wasn't hungry. Her heart was so broken, she refused to eat. She wasn't hungry. Maybe some of you can relate to that. Maybe that resonates with some of you. But in her life, that was a turning point. It changed the trajectory of her life. Changed her life forever. I would have never met her had she not gone through the turning point. I would never have even come into contact with her. She wouldn't have been in the nightclub that I was in that night. Ah, oh, come on, Taylor. Can we just talk? I'm going to tell you like Joan Rivers. Can we talk? Some of you don't know who Joan Rivers is. Yeah, I wasn't saved. Listen, the reason I wore jeans today is to let some of y'all know it doesn't take a suit to be blessed. That's why I wore jeans today. I wanted you to know I got normal clothes, too. I have normal clothes, too. Amen. Although, like my suits. Amen. Don't take my suits. Please don't take my suits away from me. But sometimes when you're at a turning point, what it does is it changes your life forever. And if you had not had that particular turning point, you wouldn't be the person you are today. Some of you wouldn't be the mother you are, or the father or brother or sister or mentor you are today if you had not had a turning what? A turning point. And whether we realize it or not, Everybody has a turning point. Everybody. But Jesus' turning point was the water baptism. That was the point in his life when not only was he announced, but he was anointed. You see, for those that don't know, when John took Jesus down into the water and he was baptized, the Bible says that the heavens opened up. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit descended from heaven like a dove, not a dove, not a bird. He descended gracefully like a dove. He lighted upon Jesus, which means he came upon Jesus. And when he came upon Jesus, the Bible says that there was a voice from heaven. And the voice said, "This is my beloved Son." Come on, somebody. In whom I am well pleased. I am well pleased. So the Holy Spirit comes down. He anoints Jesus for the work of ministry. Listen, anytime the Spirit of God comes upon you, anytime he comes into your life, that's a turning point. Anytime. And that changes your life forever because the Holy Spirit brings salvation. Oh, my God. If you don't get anything else today, get that. The Spirit of God brings salvation. So we all need a turning point, because without a turning point, we'll find ourselves serving in ministry without Jesus. Let me say that one more time. We all need a turning point. Listen, I'm talking to church people and non-church people at the same time. We all need a turning point, because without a turning point, remember, a turning point is when the Holy Spirit comes. Without a turning point, we'll find ourselves serving in ministry without Jesus. Working in the parking lot without Jesus. Working as a greeter at the front door without Jesus. Ushering without Jesus. Playing without Jesus. Ministering without Jesus. But you cannot do anything without Jesus in the house of God, because it's like somebody who's trying to give you hope, but they don't have any hope. They're trying to give you some peace, but you see that they don't have any peace in their own life. You know what I'm talking about? People who are always unhappy and then try to tell you to be happy. How many of you know you can't give people, thank you, what you don't have? No, you can't. If Corey, if I come to Corey right now, just fine, handsome Corey. If I come to Corey right now and I say, "Corey, I need to borrow $10,000. Corey's going to look just the way he's looking right now. Like, it doesn't matter what you need. I don't have it. Why? Because you can't give people what you don't have. Try to go to Dunkin' Donuts and get a pizza. You can't get a pizza from Dunkin' Donuts. They can't give you what they don't have, what they don't have. So let me digress. Jesus was at a turning point. And it was the water baptism. He had been anointed by God, and he received the power of God. But the Bible says that after he received the power of God, you know, the Holy Spirit comes and rests on him. After that, the Bible says, well, no, let me tell you this. I would think that after you receive this great power, you would go preach some revival and save a whole country. I would think that after you receive the power of God is what created the world. And he spoke and there was light. That's the power of God. I would think that God would send you off somewhere to heal a whole nation. To heal broken bones and raise the dead. But the Bible says that after he received the power, he was tempted. Well, that's no kind of reward. Wait, Lord, you're telling me that if I fast, pray, dedicate my life to you, get saved, accept Jesus, get filled with the Spirit, you're telling me that I have to then be tempted? That doesn't even seem right. But I want to tell you this. All temptation is not bad. I can see your minds working. You're like, the ones that I've been through have been pretty bad. All temptations are not bad, just like all lust is bad. You can lust after good things. I hope you lust after some good things. You can lust after success. You can lust after knowledge. You can lust after some good things. And in like manner, you can be tempted to do some good things. Anybody ever said to you, have you ever heard the expression, tempt me, I might try that. Right? Sometimes when men flirt with women, women flirt with men, and she may say to him, if you do that, you're going to owe me a dinner. He's going to say, don't tempt me. Okay, I would say that. How about that? All temptation is not bad, right? All temptation is not bad. The devil wants to make you feel like everything is bad. You can't do nothing. You can't go anywhere. You can't even say anything. Oh, if you're a Christian, oh, no, your life is over. But I want to tell you this. There may come a day, and I believe there will be a day, when some of you will be tempted to give millions of dollars to the kingdom of God. And I don't want you to think that's strange. I really believe that can happen. Let me tell you why. Because if you are the type of person that has the mind to donate to the kingdom of God, God will have the mind to donate to you. If you are the type of person that always wants to make sure that the house of God has resources, God will have the mind to always make sure you have resources. He will supply all of your need according to his riches in glory. But can I tell you the little secret? God is not in the habit of giving people things that he can't get back from them readily. I want to let that sink in for a second. No, he's not. Have you ever given a little child, given a little baby, you give them their iPad or you give them the piece of paper, and they take it from you and they say, what? Mine. Then when you go to get it back from them, they go, mine. And you want to say, you little rascal. No, you don't. You don't want to say that. You don't want to say that. But you have to teach them to give it what? To give it back, don't you? I was working with little Sarai the other day. Where is she? I just saw her in here somewhere. I was working with little Sarai. She came and she gave me something. Or I gave her something. And then I put my hand out for her to give it back to me. And then she was hesitant. But then she gave it back to me. And I said, thank you. And then we played this game. You've played the little game. I played the little game with her where I would hand it to her. She would say thank you, and then she would hand it back. I'd say thank you, and then I'd say please, and you know, you teach them how to do that, don't you? All right. Is that why some of our kids are like, give it to me? Let me come back off your street. I'm gonna get off your street. Let me get off your street. It amazes me when children are so disrespectful to adults. I'm talking about they're disrespectful to 20-year-olds. Yeah. Teacher asks them something, they're like, nah, I ain't doing that. Right, Sister Linda? All right, I better stop. I don't want social services on my door. You can be tempted to do good things. You can be tempted to go to school. You can be tempted to get your degree. You could be tempted to marry your high school sweetheart. You could be tempted to travel around the world. You could be tempted to donate to all kinds of charities. There are many temptations that will come your way. In fact, some of us need to be tempted to become financially disciplined and get a budget. Hold on. Some of us. Now, if you've been at this church for a while, you know Pastor Robinson is big on budgets. Not for my sake, because your lack of budget doesn't affect my budget. But your lack of budget does affect your spiritual life. Because how many of you know money are the worst? Your hair will fall out, all kinds of stuff happens. Stress, it's just stressful. So some of us need to be tempted to get a little budget. Some of us need to know a little better how to manage our money. That's okay. They don't teach this in school. Did you know that? You can be an economics major or an accountant, and they don't teach you about budgeting in college or in high school. So now you have to come to the house of God or to some workshop to be taught it, but you've got to be taught it. And it doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are, you cannot be the person who refuses to accept help. And I'm not saying to ask for help from me or from the church, or I'm just saying get some. Just get YouTube. Somebody say get some.
Get some.
Somebody right now is tempted to get some help with their budget. Man, I don't even know who I'm talking to. I don't even plan on talking about money. But it's okay. The Lord will teach you. Did you know when we first started this church, we're all in our 20s, and most of the members lived in apartments. And the reason they lived in apartments was not because they didn't have the money to buy a home. They were all in the military. And you can get a VA loan and put no money down. The reason they didn't have homes is because they were never taught they could be homeowners. So immediately, my wife and I began to teach them, oh, no, you can have a house. You can have a home. You can buy a home. The same price you're paying for that apartment, you could be paying for your own property. And before you know it, within 2 years, 90% of the young people single and married in the church own homes. I hope I'm tempting somebody. Oh, let me move on. All temptation is not bad, right? So let me talk to you about three temptations that Jesus experienced when he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness or the desert. When he was led by the Spirit, let me talk about these three temptations. The reason I want to talk about these three temptations is because these three temptations are the same temptations that every single person on the face of the earth faces in their life. Go to Matthew, the 4th chapter, and the first verse. The first temptation is called the lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh. Matthew 4:1. It says, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. First thing I want to tell you is that this particular word tempted in the Greek can also be translated. Tempted can also be translated. First of all, the Greek word is parazo, but it can also be translated to make proof of, to tempt, or to test. To make proof of, to tempt, or to test. And in fact, what we were really saying is Jesus was led of the Spirit to be tested in the wilderness. Some theologians actually believe that this particular passage of Scripture that we're reading from should not be called the temptation of Jesus, which is how it's titled in most Bibles. But they believe it could be called the testing of Jesus because Jesus was experiencing both a temptation and a test. One person that you meet might say they're going through a temptation. Another person you meet might say they're going through a test. But I will tell you that regardless of what you feel like you're going through, God has a purpose for every test. What you're going through is not in vain. What you're feeling is not in vain. And the test that you're in the middle of right now, the thing you're going through right now, God has already said, listen, if you will allow him to help you, he will change the rest of your life. This could be a turning point for you. Yeah. Can I say this? This is not in the Bible. But if you will permit me to help you, this will help you for the rest of your life. Whatever test you're going through, whatever you're experiencing right now, you have to pass it. No. There are no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You must pass. If it's ordained by God, you've got to pass your test. Because one thing is for sure, God will make you take it again. If you don't pass it the first time, he will make you take it again, over and over and over. You'll go through the same relationships over and over. You'll go through the same financial problems over and over. You'll go through the same church problems over and over. You can't get along with this person, can't get along with that person. It just seems like I can't find a right place for me to be. I want to tell you something. Many times it's not the place, it's us. See, and some of us in the sanctuary right now, you understand what I'm talking about, this whole testing thing, because some of us are on our second test. Now I'm looking over here. Some of us are on our third and fourth and fifth and sixth. Listen, join the club. Every one of us is going to be tested. All the retesters know what I'm talking about. All of you who had to come in, me and you were in remedial class. Class in when I was in school for people who couldn't swim well. One of the mandates in my school was that you had to be able to swim. And so since I couldn't swim very well, they put all of us swim into this class, and it was called subclass. And you know how the military is, they're not nice. It meant subpar. So we would always say, hey, I'm in the subclass. But it really meant you were in the subpar class. You were an underperformer, underachiever, right? But so what? We may be in a remedial class right now, but you still have to pass the what? Look at somebody and tell them, say, just pass your test. Just pass your test. Corey, just pass your test. Just pass. Just pass. Just pass. Excuse me. Just pass the test. Matthew 4:2. And when he had fasted, 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungered. He was hungry, right? Verse 2 says he fasted 40 days. He was hungry. And this particular verse is actually one of the evidences of Jesus' humanity. I think I spoke to you a couple of weekends ago, and I told you that many people believe that Jesus was 100% God and 100% man when he was on earth, but that is not true. Because you know for yourself, you can't be 100%, 200% of anything. It always makes me laugh when people say, he gave 150%. You can't do that. That's impossible. You can't give what you don't have. So Jesus was not 100% God and 100% man. He was on earth. That meant he was two people. When he was on earth, he was a man. And he was a man with a divine nature. And the way we know that he was a man is because it says he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterward he was what? Child, please. You know from for yourself, from reading theology, that gods don't get hungry. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. So the enemy attacks Jesus in his flesh because Jesus is hungry, right? He attacks him in the flesh. And here's the thing about the flesh. Wherever you're weakest, that's where the devil attacks you. If you did not smoke when you were in sin, he's not going to tempt you with cigarettes after you. You didn't drink alcohol when you were in sin. Listen, I didn't drink alcohol when I was in sin. So no one ever comes to me and says, hey, Pastor Rob, you want a beer? Nobody ever says that. Not because I'm above that, because the devil knows that won't work with me. What does the devil know won't work with you? What areas do you have beat? Some of you, you never gambled in your life. So he's not going to tempt you with Las Vegas. I went to Las Vegas a couple of months ago. And we had to, you know how they do it. When you stay at the hotel, you have to walk through the casino to get through the desk. Y'all know. Don't act like you haven't been in. And when I was walking through the casino, the whole time I was thinking to myself, these people are so foolish. To come to a location and know you're going to waste money. When I was coming up, I would see whole churches, busloads of people being shipped or driving to a casino. Oh, let me just get on back. Come on. I don't want to offend my gambling folks, my gambling saints. I bet you Jesus is coming back. Let me keep going. He will attack you where you're weakest. He will attack you with whatever struggle you had when you were in sin. And when you get saved, when you become a Christian, that's when you'll find out what you were weakest at. Because the first thing he will do is bring back to you what you struggled with. That is why so many Christians have a problem with not listening to worldly music. Oh, you got quiet. You see that? Y'all were like, you were doing real good, Pastor. That's why we have a problem when somebody says, hey, you probably shouldn't listen to Beyonce because she's teaching you to fornicate. Do I have to pull a Tim Tebow on you? Listen. The music we used to listen to was preparatory for the actions we used to commit. You listened to a particular type of music before it was time to go on your date. You listened to a particular type of music before it was time to go to the party. You listened to a particular type of music when you were sad and your heart was broken. You would listen to the blues. You listened to your slow music. You put on your little jam session. And then you'd feel so bad. How come we still want to listen to the same music? Oh, come on. Just tell the truth and shame the devil. You might still be listening to it. That's okay. That's not for me. I don't have the keys to heaven and hell. I'm just telling you the consequences of listening to certain music. It leads you into certain actions. So when I first got saved, I had like $7,000 worth of music. And I gave it all away. I shouldn't have given it away, mind you. It's like a drug dealer giving his drugs away. But I gave it all away. Immediately, I gave it all away. Why? Because I knew that when I would listen to certain music, it would make me feel a certain way. I played college basketball, and there was a song that I would listen to before every game because it made me angry. And I will tell you, it was by Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre. I knew you'd like that because they were performing at the Super Bowl. But I listened to it because it made me what? Angry. You know what I'm talking about. How can we fight the Spirit when he's telling us truth? Our flesh, it's just our flesh. We just don't want to give it up. But Pastor, that's an oldie but goodie. No, that's an oldie but sinny. I'm just going to move on. Lord Jesus. I didn't plan on talking about that. Please come back next Sunday. I don't apologize for preaching the gospel. I don't apologize for having sincere concern for your soul. I don't apologize because I'm not concerned about you putting money into Jay-Z's pocket. I don't apologize because I just don't apologize. But I do want you to come back next Sunday. All right, so let me just look at this next verse. Verse 3 says, and when the tempter came, this is Matthew 4 and 3. And when the tempter came, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be turned into bread. So Jesus was hungry. So Satan attacked him where he was weakest. His flesh was hungry. So I told you, Satan will always attack you where you're weakest. And then one of the reasons Satan attacks you is because he hates you. So what Pastor Robinson, hate is a very strong word. Yes, and Satan is a very strong evil spirit. He's an angel. I'm sorry, he's an angel. But he hates you. Why does he hate you? Why does he hate you? You didn't do anything to him. He hates you. He hates you because you were created the image of God. He hates you because God said in Genesis 1 and 27, let us create man in our image. He hates you because you look like God. Your body's like God. Your hands are like God's hands. Your eyes are like God's eyes. Listen, God is not a spirit floating around. He sits on a throne in heaven. When the Bible says God is a spirit, it simply means that he has a spiritual body. That means it cannot be killed. It's a spiritual body, physical body, a mortal body. He has an immortal body, and he's located somewhere. The Bible says that his throne is at the most northern part of the universe. Right? And so, God, one of the reasons the devil was so upset with Jesus, is if anybody on the face of the earth looked like God, Jesus looked like God. Jesus reminded the devil of where he used to live. Jesus reminded the devil of who really had the power. You know, you can have people in your life who think they have power until they run into somebody who really has power. Mm-hmm. That's what bullies do. Bullies think that they have power. But all you have to do, don't do this, I'm sorry. Okay, so this is BC. This is BC, Brother Joshua. BC, all you would have to do is punch them in the throat. Did you know people don't, they're not very tough when they can't breathe? Okay, so now let's come back to church. Come back to church. That's all BC. Don't hold that against me, Brother Caleb. Don't hold it against me. That was BC. That was BC. I told you I would listen to a song that would make me what? Angry. Thank God I'm not angry anymore. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. All right, let me wrap this up. Let's just go to Matthew 4 and 4. How about that? Let's go to Matthew 4. The Bible says in Matthew 4 and 4, it says, Jesus said, essentially it says, here it is, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. In other words, yes, devil, I'm hungry. Yes, devil, I haven't eaten in 40 days. Yes, I'm weary, wounded, and sad. And really his body had begun to go into a period of starvation. That's what science says. At around the 40-day mark, you begin to starve. But Jesus said, I can't eat your bread. He says, I've got to accept, or I have to go by the word of God. Let me just encourage you with this. When temptation comes, the best defense, the best weapon is the word of God. The Bible calls it the sword of the Spirit. The best defense is the word of God. And then the funny thing is sometimes people get confused when we talk about the lust of the flesh, like we don't know what the lust of the flesh is. When you can't turn the TV on without seeing the lust of the what? Of the flesh. But let me give you some practical application. We talked about this yesterday, didn't we, Sister Jill? Let me give you some practical application so that we understand when I say lust of the flesh. I'm going to give you a couple of statements that you might be able to use. Okay? Are you ready? Yes. Here's one statement. I will not compromise my values for money. For it is written, the love of money is the root of all evil. I will not compromise my standards before marriage. Even if he or she tells me they love me. Oh, Jesus. I can't tell y'all how many people have told me, well, he said he loved me. And now he's gone. And now she's gone. I will not compromise my standards before marriage because it is written in 1 Thessalonians 4, it says that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and in honor. I will not lie on someone for my benefit. For it's written that thou shalt not bear false witness against thy brother. I will not put that in my body. I will not defile my body. I will not put that on my body. For it is written that my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, or the temple of God. Let me tell you one last one. And this is for every age. Now, some of you are going to say, this is just for young people. No, it's not, because I see adults who can't put their phones down. I will not let my mind be consumed with social media all day long. I did not tell you you can't go on social media. For it is written that whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, and whatsoever things have virtue, think on these things. Can you use any of those statements? That's the lust of the flesh. Let me move on to the next one. The next one is the pride of life. So we have the lust of the flesh. Now we have the pride of life. The pride of life is one that are going to face at one time or another. What is the pride of life? The pride of life is really defined as anything that leads to arrogance or pride or presumption. Presumption means you feel entitled. Or anything that leads to boasting. The pride of life, the pride of having things, the pride of showing other people that you have some stuff. Matthew 4 and 5 says this. It says, then the devil taketh him up to the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple and saith to him, if thou be the Son of God, cast yourself down, for it is written. Now notice the devil starts using it is written. The devil starts using the Bible. The devil uses the Bible, y'all. So every person who quotes a scripture isn't of God. Amen. He shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou shalt dash thy foot against the stone. The devil said, Jesus, throw yourself off this hill. He says, and don't worry, you won't die, because the Bible says that the angels will catch you. Right? So what the devil was trying to do is he was trying to tempt Jesus to force God into a supernatural event. In other words, he was trying to make Jesus manipulate God. And sometimes people try to manipulate God. They say, Lord, if you just get me out of this situation, I'll never, you know. Oh, no. That's manipulation. You shouldn't have done it in the first place. Lord, now that I've messed everything up, if you just fix this, I promise. No, that's manipulation. I'm seeing that some of us have prayed a whole lot of manipulative prayers, including me. But let me say this. He was trying to appeal to the desire that's in every man to receive God's approval while that approval is being publicly demonstrated. In other words, we want everybody to know that we're blessed. We want everybody to know that we belong to God. But how many of you know that regardless of whether or not the outside world knows you're blessed, you're still blessed? Regardless of whether your boss, your coworkers, your friends, your families, or your neighbors know you're blessed, you don't have to go buy a BMW to show that you're blessed. Blessed is not in possessions of material things. Blessed is in possession of spiritual things. So you don't have to do that, because we have to be very careful not to seek the approval of man over the approval of God. Could Jesus have jumped off the hill or the pinnacle of that temple and do you think that the angels would have caught him? Sure, he's the Son of God. I mean, he had a mission to accomplish, probably. But can I tell you something? Just because you have the power to do something doesn't mean you should. Just because you have the authority to do something doesn't mean that you should. So what did Jesus say? He said, no, I'm not going to do that, because it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And I just want to encourage you. Don't go out and buy the latest thing to prove to somebody else that you're blessed. Amen. You don't need the latest 9,000-inch television screen. Right? 200 inches will do just fine. Just to show somebody, don't go buy the latest car just to show you, to keep up with the neighbor. I've got a neighbor, one of my neighbors, all three of his cars have over 700 horsepower. He's got a Dodge Hellcat, a Corvette Z07, 8, 9, 10, something, something, and something else that makes a lot of noise when it comes out of the garage. And I get a Honda Civic, I put my legs in my Honda Civic, and I drive on. You know why? Because I don't need a car to show you that I'm blessed. Do you need that to prove to somebody else that God is on your side? No. Because the Lord says that if you belong to him and he belongs to you, the world will know. Because righteousness will go before you. Oh, my God. Thank you, Jesus. See, I just saved y'all a whole lot of money. You don't need the latest iPad. You don't need the latest $1,400 iPhone. My iPhone, the saints always get very upset with me because all my technological devices are like 8 years old. My newest device is my iPhone, and I got that in 2020. That's my newest device. But some of us say, oh, but my contract says I'm eligible for an upgrade. No, boo-boo. What that means is you're eligible to pay for another $1,400 for a phone. I don't understand it. I just can't. If Lord bless me with a budget. Oh, Jesus. Lust of the flesh, pride of life. Lust of the flesh, pride of life. Let me finish. The last one is the lust of the eyes. Last one is the lust of the eyes. All right. Matthew 4:8. It simply says again. The devil takes him up into an exceeding high mountain and shows him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and said unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Isn't that just like the devil? Isn't it just like the devil to promise you something that doesn't belong to him? How can he give you the world when the world doesn't belong to him? But isn't it just like the devil to show you something that looks really good but will probably kill you? Look at these Twinkies. Just look at them. Yeah, I know you don't like Twinkies, but you like chili cheese fries with all that other stuff on it. Just have a couple of them. The devil will show you houses, money, cars that you can have. He'll tell you, you can be just like those entertainers. You can be just like the movie stars. You can be just like the singers. If you just fall down and worship me, you can be just like them. You can be like LeBron James. You can be like the professional athlete. No, you can't. You can't jump. You can't run. Can't sing. Just be you. Look at somebody say, just be you. Just be you. Just be you. But the devil says you can be all of these things you see on TV, but that's the lust of the eyes. You can have bling bling. You can have all the stuff. You can have hair and the extensions. You can have all of the Jimmy Choo shoes and red bottom. What do they call those red bottom shoes? What are they called? Those. As my daughter would say, that. You can have all of that if you just fall down and worship me. But how many of you know? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world but lose his soul? And lose his soul. And the enemy is telling too many of us today, too many of our young people, that if they would just give up this church, if they would just get out of this whole religious thing, because, you know, religion is man-made, that's not true. That's a lie. Religion is not man-made. The scriptures are made by God. The order and structure and rank structure and authority is made by God. Did you know that your military, everyone who's military, raise their hand, was or is, former, prior, whatever, raise your hand. Your entire military structure comes from Scripture. That's why they would call them the captain of the host or the captain of the, or the general of the army. Our entire military structure comes from Scripture. Everything, even in the Supreme Court, it used to be that the basis of their belief system was the Ten Commandments. So the enemy tells young people, if you just get away from this church, just, you don't need anybody telling you what to do. You're your own person. In fact, not only are you your own person, you can do what you want, when you want, where you want, with whomever you want. In fact, you don't even have to be you. You can call yourself something else. And then if they try to say that you're not what you call yourself, sue them. And go to whatever bathroom you want to go into, mind you. Somebody said, not mine. The enemy, can't you see it? The enemy tells young people, you don't have to follow any rules. Just dare to be different. You don't have to do anything, especially stay away from religion. Just be spiritual. Is this true, Kristen? Is this what they're telling folks? That's what the young people are telling me. They're like, oh no, all my friends, they said that religion is man-made. They said that this is just trying to control you. Listen, what control do I have over your life? That's like your seventh grade teacher, your fourth grade teacher. That's like you thinking they're trying to control you. They already have their degree. They don't need you. That's what my mama used to tell me. She said, boy, go to that class and be quiet. She said, because Miss Crabtree has her degree. Pastor Rob got his degree. I'm just trying to help you. The lust of the flesh, the pride of life, the lust of the eyes. The Bible says that after the comes to Jesus that last time and shows him the world and says, you can have all of this if you just fall down and worship me. The Bible says that Jesus rejects that with the word of God, right? Because Jesus knows that, one, he knows he created it. The Bible says that all things were made. I'm sorry, I don't want to talk like you know this. The Bible says all things were made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made. So when people say, get rid of religion, get rid of church, get rid of Bibles, they're trying to get rid of the one who created everything. That's the devil. Right? So then the Bible says when Jesus rejects him, that the devil leaves him for a season, leaves him alone. And sometimes you just need the enemy enough for you to make a rational decision about Christ. That's it. You just need him to go long enough and I want to say this to you today. I don't know what test you're going through. I don't know what temptation you're facing. I do know you need to pass the test. But I also know that right now, Satan will leave you alone just long enough for you to make an intelligent decision for Christ. I want you to stand. I know without a shadow of a doubt that even as you're standing, I know that every one of us in here is in some type of battle. Because this is a spiritual warfare. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities and evil spirits. Whether we realize it or not, the enemy is constantly battling for our soul. Somebody told me yesterday, they said, I told them what the title of my message was, and they said, well, that doesn't sound like it sounds like it's gonna bring everybody down. It doesn't sound like it's gonna, I said, don't worry, I won't bring everybody down. Can't you see the Lord is trying to lift you up? He's trying to make it so you don't have to have a broken heart. So you don't have to be disappointed by friends who don't really love you. And by the way, friends who don't really love you aren't friends. He's trying to make it so that you don't have to wonder where your next meal is coming from or where the next job is coming from, because the Lord will provide for you. And my prayer right now is that the enemy would just leave us alone just for a moment. Everybody lift your hands. Just for a moment. Just for a moment. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can you tell him thank you? And you say, why am I thanking him? You're saying thank you for my health and strength. Thank you for having a sound mind. Thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you for the mind to be in church. Well, I may not be what I'm supposed to be, but I'm not what I used to be. I thank you for bringing me a mighty long way. And Father, I thank you for a second chance. Somebody needs a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Spirit of the living God, we come before you today. And we thank you. We give you glory and we give you honor. We give you praise. Lord, I look out about over this congregation and see your hearts. I see people who have come into this sanctuary wanting to be right with you. Father, you said that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Lord, if we would accept your son Jesus, if we would just accept Jesus, just accept Jesus, you said he would forgive us. Lord, for this moment, we resist the lust of the flesh. We resist the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. And we accept Jesus. Jesus, we need you to give us breath. Maybe you need this prayer. I pray this every day. I ask God to forgive me every day. But maybe you're here and you know that you're away from God and you need to say this prayer with us. Just say, Jesus, I need you. I need you to forgive me. And maybe you're like me and you need to say this. Lord, I need your help. I'm weak, but you are strong. Please save me. Come into my heart. Change my mind. Yeah, that's a turning point for some of you right now. Change my mind. The Lord is turning you right now. He's turning you right now. Spirit of the living God, begin to turn their heart, turn their mind. Lord, change my mind. I give you my heart. And I give you my life. And I will live for you all the days of my life if you help me. Father, I'm praying for those that are in the sanctuary today. Lord, when I was ministering, Father, about finances, some who were sitting in the sanctuary were crying out for help in the Spirit. And there's somebody's finances that are so, for lack of a better term, they're just so messed up that you can't even see a way out. Oh my God. And you are in the bondage of finances right now. You don't know what blessed looks like because of what you're going through. But the Lord said, you will turn it over to him and ask for help. He will fix it. And you will look back and you will wonder how you made it out. Father, whomever that is, oh my God, Lord, whoever she is, whoever he is, minister to our finances. Change our heart about our money. Give us a heart after your heart. Save us so that we can make saved decisions. And Lord, let us know, whoever that is, the Spirit says, this is not the end for you. This is not the end of your life. You don't have to feel like everything is over. The Lord says, this is a turning point for you. This is a new beginning. In the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for healing today as we're closing. I pray for healing today. If you need a touch in your body, I'm just going to ask if you would take it to the ailment. Doesn't matter what the ailment, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Take a step into the aisle. I'm praying for all manner of sicknesses. I'm praying for one thing the Lord wants me to pray for is joint pain. Joint pain. Joint pain. Blood conditions. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Right there. Nobody else move. Nobody else move. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in Jesus' name, everyone who took a step of faith, that's what you did. Everyone who took a step of faith, send your Spirit right now. Lord, Brother Chris, he's standing in the gap for his wife. Touch Sister Angela in her body in Jesus' name. And Lord, regardless of statistics, regardless of analytics or what the doctors may think, bless this baby. And let her be a miracle. Father, I'm praying that you would heal every joint condition in this room. Lord, those that are waking up in pain and going to bed in pain, so that they would no longer have to take medicine to make it through the day. My God, to make it through the day. Send your healing in Jesus' name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Tell them, say, thank you for my healing. Thank you for, that's for whoever that was, that's for you. Thank you for my healing. Thank you for my deliverance. In Jesus' name. Oh, my God. Father, in Jesus' name, I'm praying for this blood condition, these blood conditions. Lord, I'm praying for this blood pressure. My God, I'm praying for this blood pressure, Lord. I'm praying, Lord, for these conditions that the doctors can't even figure out, but they know it has to do with the blood. Because of the blood Jesus shed, give us a transfusion and replace our blood with the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. There is healing in the blood of Jesus. Lord, heal me. That's you. That's your faith. This is your faith talking. Lord, heal me. I believe that you can, and I believe that you will, in Jesus' name. Lord, last but not least, Lord, I want you to bless every person. I want you to bless every young person in this building, asking in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would encourage them. Lord, let them know that this is not old-fashioned. This is not old religion. It was from the beginning, and it will be until the end. This is from everlasting to everlasting. And Lord, the best thing that could ever happen to us is Jesus. And the method may look different, but it's the same gospel. Put a running in their feet. Put a fire in their belly. No, we vow that we'll give you glory for keeping and saving our young people. We vow that we'll give you praise. Thank you for continuing to add souls to harvest, Lord. Lord, not that We know that you're adding souls to the kingdom of God, not just this local church. And we bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you give God a great big hand? Bless his name. 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 Bless Lord. Amen. You may be seated very briefly. I just want to tell you, normally my wife would give any closing announcements, but I do want to tell you that Sister Jill Clark has been teaching a Sunday morning Christian education, not Sunday morning, a Saturday Christian education training for anyone that is interested in becoming a teacher here at Harvest. And we have it every other Saturday. So we had one yesterday. We'll have one in 2 weeks. The information is on our website. But if you're interested in becoming a teacher, right? Now, this doesn't guarantee, let me say this is a PSA. This doesn't guarantee that everyone who attends the training will be teaching immediately, right? But it will give you the skills and the tools needed to become an effective teacher, because many times the 90% of our ministry, I always say 95% of our ministry is outside the church. It's outside of the pulpit and outside of the church. And so, but this class will give you the tools and the resources and how to minister to others, how to teach, and how to share the gospel. So please check our website out for that. Additionally, if you'd like to connect the church, if you'd like to make sure that you have the latest and greatest of what's going on, all you have to do is text the word connect to 757, I think it's 847, or I don't know, they'll put it on the screen. 8475 something. They'll put it on the screen. So, but you'll just text this number. It's 547. And I ain't got no help in the sanctuary. The Bible said he would send help from the sanctuary. Hey, there it is. There we go. 847-5277. 847-5277. Just text the word connect. Amen. If you're a guest today and you didn't fill out a guest card, you can always just text the word welcome to that number, and then it will allow you to provide your information. And if you're interested in becoming a member of Harvest Church, you can text the word join to that same number. Amen. I do want to give a special acknowledgement to Brother Lawrence Corm's mother. And what's your first name, ma'am? Is it Tamara? Sister Tamara, and you're coming all the way from what state? Oh, she's coming all the way from Carlisle, Pennsylvania. Carlisle, Pennsylvania. Can you say praise the Lord for her? Amen. Praise the Lord. Her son plays our steel drums, and he's just a young soldier over in the... I told him he reminds me of myself because he's a young soldier over at Langley Air Force Base, and the Lord is blessing him and raising him up. Amen. So I think that's everything. I'm just going to ask that you would stand. I'm so grateful that you're in the house of God today. I want you to take your Sunday where? Take your Sunday into Monday. Tell somebody about what you learned today. Amen. Don't tell them everything probably, huh? But tell them what you learned today. Amen. And encourage them. Come back next Sunday. Amen. Well, first of all, Wednesday at 7:30, we'll have Bible study. Please join us for Bible study online at 7:30. Amen. So we're just going to sing our little closing song, and then we'll be dismissed. And it says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord. For he is good, he is good. Unto-